Welcome everyone at the session about durable functions. Question up front, is there anyone who doesn't understand Dutch? Great. Welcome everyone also from abroad. We'll do it in English then, no worries. So who am I? Carl Anteveld, I'm a full stack software engineer. You can find me out at Twitter, always eager to hear from you, news, questions, don't matter. Please reach out to me and also always good to feel your energies. I work with Capgemini, full of other good software engineers like me. We have a stand as well, so please come by and play the game and hopefully you will win the prize. The outline of the talk. We have 45 minutes. It's packed with demos. But before we can start with demos, a brief introduction towards durable functions. What is durable functions? It's an advanced extension on top of Azure Functions, so we all need to know what Azure Functions is. And before we can start with Azure Functions, we need to know what serverless is. So let's kick off. Who of you do work in the cloud with your products and solutions? Okay, everyone is familiar with cloud. So this, all these abbreviations, I believe everyone can guess. What does IaaS mean? Infrastructure as a service. That's where cloud started way back, just lifting and shifting virtual machines towards an external party hosting your infrastructures. PaaS, platform as a service. Next incarnation, removing your maintenance of the operating system, outsourcing it towards your service provider. And the latest evolution is serverless. So what's the, there's a gray area, obviously, between platform and serverless. So both of them share the concept of abstraction of servers. But what's the special thing about serverless? It's whereas you can deploy your monolith, 1 million lines of code, legacy code, on top of a modern cloud platform, no worries. But if you really want to leverage serverless compute, you need to think of your, break down your monolith into smaller pieces, into microservices, into little components. And if you drop them on a serverless platform, then you get benefits like instant scale, based on the demands of your customers. So for example, you have a website, and at some point you could get a lot of customers on your website. Your serverless platform will scale up instantaneously, and after all those demand goes away, it scales down automatically, even on top towards a zero point in that you're not consuming anything on the platform, and you will not get billed for any costs. So that's the micro billing aspect. You only get billed for the specific components that really use those resources. I believe this is not new to anyone. Obviously, Microsoft is providing lots of stuff in this space. Functions, of course. Function is the full code offering, so we as a software engineer are really fond of using Azure Functions. We are in full control of the business logic we define. There's no designer, there's no JSON schemas involved. So we have, from a software engineer perspective, full control on what is happening below the waters. Whereas Logic Apps, that is an offering for business analysts, comes with a designer, so people that don't have a software engineering background will have a design canvas and can design their logic flow easily without much code. So that's a low-code, no-code offering. Latest addition to this spectrum is the Event Grid. It's just a routing platform for eventing. Of course, all those integrate great with all the Azure backend stuff, so like storage and analytics. And obviously, Microsoft is providing very great development tooling. So you have super support in Visual Studio, Visual Studio Code, etc. You have integration with build pipelines for your continuous integration, continuous delivery. You can deploy Azure Functions easily. Nowadays, even the DevOps platforms from other parties, not only TFS of Azure or the Azure DevOps, but also Jenkins, for example. Monitoring support, everything is in place for these new serverless stuff. Well, we can delve a bit deeper in what's Azure Functions. Azure Functions is a threefold process. Obviously, you write your code. This code needs to have a trigger. So you can think of a web request or a timer trigger or an incoming event. The code is happening and the code will output something in the form of yet another event or a database action or mail sending through. That's the whole acky thing. In the box, Azure Functions is based on an open source binding framework. Microsoft has a lot of bindings in place. Everyone is invited to write their own bindings for all kinds of other third-party platforms. The latter two are of interest for this day's talk. The Durable Task extension, which really enables this Durable Functions flow within the Azure Functions stack. It's only became globally available recently, last year. And we're also leveraging the SignalR service today. And fun factor is that the 1.0 has only became globally available last week. So until during the preparation of this talk, we were using a beta version of the SignalR binding. So we're always in the cloud, catching up with the latest, greatest. But do note that although the binding has become globally available just only last week, the Azure SignalR service was already globally available since September. So there's much more production experience over there. Okay, Azure Functions. It's really about a short-lived, stateless, simple code. Obviously, our problem space with our customers is not only about short-lived, simple, stateless. What would be the answer to all of this? How could we tackle this? Any suggestions from the room? What would be the Microsoft solution to solve stuff that is not short-lived, that is not stateless? Durable functions, unbelievable. So what is not easily fixed with standard Azure Functions? So all of these process patterns, I'm really fond of patterns. So managing a sequence, handling errors, recovering from errors is very difficult to have this in the stateless flow. Human interaction, how to respond to human events. Difficult. How to monitor a long-running process in a flexible manner, orchestrating that, difficult. Fanning out, fanning in, so scheduling parallel lots of tasks and then doing something with the end result is hard. How to orchestrate that all. External events correlation and long-running APIs and then polling the state of that. So all of these will be answered with durable functions. Advanced extension, I already said that. It is leveraging the open source Drupal Task Framework. Originally it was closed source back in 2014. It was leveraging Azure Service Bus. The past few years they refactored this framework and really made it suitable for Azure storage. Azure storage is a zero cost when there's no consumption, whereas Service Bus is has a monthly fee already without any use. So it's not really Service Bus was not really suitable for serverless consumption planned stuff. What can you do with durable functions? We can all read slides, so long-running orchestrations in a single function maintaining state reliably. You can easily call functions singularly, other functions singularly or asynchronously. And the same message goes for durable functions like functions. We as software engineers are in full control. There are no surprises with JSON schemas or strange designers we need to understand domain-specific languages. No, we can pick our language. Currently, there's support for .NET and JavaScript. I'm a full-stack developer, so I have experience with Node.js and .NET. Who of you are using Node.js in the cloud? I was thinking that most people from a Microsoft world are coming from .NET. So the message is Microsoft has full support for Node.js. Latest introduction is also the TypeScript support. So please spread the message. Also, all those geeky front-end developers should come on board on this platform. What is a durable function? It also apparently everything comes in threefold if it's good. You need to start the function. It is most times it's just a function that is an HTTP triggered. The starter function kicks off the orchestrator function, and the orchestrator function is the essential part that coordinates the long running process. So it schedules activity functions, and the scheduler will kick off all those activity functions. How does it look like in code? This is a C# example. There's your definition of the orchestrator. Oh, I can use my cool gadget I've picked up from Sander Hoogendoorn's talk. Let's see, this is nice, right? How is this possible? It's all AI, man. Okay, dus this is the orchestrator signature, and there you see the activity functions called. Please note the await keyword. It's who is not familiar with the async await pattern in .NET? Super. So below the borders, there is a special durable task scheduler. As soon as there is an await keyword, the scheduler will recognize that, and the activity function will be scheduled, and the orchestrator will get to sleep. So as soon as this await statement happens, the orchestrator does not take any consumption credits. And you can imagine this is in a way synchronous code. So function one gets executed, the orchestrator waits for the end results. Function two gets executed, waits for the end results, and at last function three gets called and it waits for the end result. And then you can return the aggregated output. Also, please note catch statement. So in this framework, you have full exception handling support, what you're already familiar with in .NET. No surprises over there. Let's see. This is the most difficult slide in the complete talk. So if you understand this one, then you are good to go to start with the durable functions. It's all about event sourcing, and the orchestrate function is replayed again and again and again. So from top to bottom, the first time the orchestrator function gets alive, first line is run, it signals this activity function. It will read from the event source, is this function already performed, yes or no? No, in this case it's not. The function gets scheduled, orchestrator gets into sleep, taking no credits. The activity function gets awake, will do the process. Oh, the output will get written towards the event source. The execution history will get updated. The orchestrator function gets executed again, from top to bottom. Please note, see that's happening. Second time, the activity function gets the orchestrator function, which the scheduler will decide, do I need to schedule this, or have I already the output result? Now, obviously, in the execution history, the output result is already there, so it can proceed. There you go. Clear? We'll do this is a mental map. We have prepared a little bit of demos, and they plot on top of those patterns a bit. Okay, the basic sequence. I would like to show the breakpoint behavior. I would like to start up Azure Storage Explorer and to show you how the event history looks like. And we will be leveraging Postman. Is anyone familiar with Postman? For REST API calls, great, nice tool. And I would like to say something about security, about the tokens that are being generated. Let's see. We go to Visual Studio first. So nowadays you install Visual Studio, you have the question: Do I want to have the Azure SDK workload? Obviously, we want to have the Azure SDK workload. So as soon as you have the Azure SDK workload, you can start writing functions, and you press F5, and the local Azure function host will get started. I have a window showing that, yes. And the SDK comes with a storage explorer. So it's the storage emulator. Is this the storage? Yes, this is the emulator. So currently the storage emulator is started. Cannot, very small letters. But all right. So those are the bit of pieces that we require to have it running locally. Okay, I will go to Postman. So I have prepared, can use my gadget again. Where is it? So 7071, that's the default port of your function host locally. There is a starter function that is registered for listening for this route. And this is our orchestrator function. So I will kick off by sending this request. Hopefully it works. Oh, and even my breakpoint is hitting already. So we can look up in the console application the output of the function host. It's stating executing our orchestrator function. Great. So you see this orchestrator binding, orchestrator trigger. And we hit our first breakpoint. F10. Everyone familiar with F10, step over behavior of your debugger. What would be the next line where we will be ending? Will it be 30? Will shout out. What would be the next line if I press F10? The same. Unbelievable. Let's try that. How is that possible? Huh? Can someone explain that?
It awaits the call to the second function and then comes back to this one.
The anyone something to add on top of that answer? The case is that the orchestrator went to sleep as soon as the await keyword was hit. The activity function was scheduled, the activity function got kicked off. And as soon as the activity function is finished, the orchestrator function gets alive again. And it's played from top to bottom. So we are currently in the replay of the second try of the orchestrator function. And as you can remember from the slide, this time the output is in the event history, so F10 will go to line 24. What will happen if I press F10? Line 23. F10, 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 line 23. F10, F10, F10. And finally, the result. Oh no. Yeah, this is signal R stuff. I haven't thought anything. I will explain that in a bit. All right, that was the first introduction to a basic sequence orchestrator. About security, one thing I had to learn is this code is really a code that is applicable for all Drupal functions. So please take care with sharing this this code towards another one person or system. Let's look a bit into the storage explorer. Super attractive screen with lots of tables. So this is an example of this event source. If there is any problem in your Drupal stack, then you can analyze further into the nitty gritty details of what's stored into Azure Storage. But please note that this don't take a dependency on it because these are implementation details. So Microsoft can always change the schema of this. Let's go back to the slide. Have I told everything we? Yes. But life would be way too simple if we only stick to Postman this talk. So what we did, we really built out a full single page application. We introduced Azure Active Directory authentication. We introduced WebSockets using SignalR. We used Angular for our full front end stack. We used Google Material Design for responsive design. And also we experimented with the Azure Storage static website. Anyone using static websites for doing demos or production or? Whereas App Service Plan is really providing a platform with backend capabilities, .NET for example, or Node.js. This static website, it does not provide any backend. It's a very cheap, cost-effective way to host your single-page application.
I have one question about it. Can you add different domains to it already?
What I believe the best way to do is to introduce a CDN front-end. But we can discuss it after the talk. Everyone can grab my code on this GitHub location and fire up all kinds of pull requests with all your improvements and ideas, issues. I'm looking forward to that. And about security, securing your functions with Azure Active Directory, there's a talk in the afternoon by Rick van den Bos. Please go listen to him. Then we arrive at demo 2. Oh yeah, this responsive web app, obviously you can run it on your mobile phone, so that is super modern to have multi-device capabilities, right? How are we doing time? It's 12 o'clock now, 20 minutes. In demo 2, we would like to say something about sub-orchestrators, how to handle external events, introducing these WebSockets. Okay. Let's show off this single-page application. Where's the browser? So everyone, let's see. This is the button. Hopefully it will work. So it kicks off an orchestrator function. This orchestrator function is doing some activities. It's cancelable. I've introduced a cancel button. Let's try out if that works. Hopefully. No. I invite all of you to debug and help me out. And now, of course, the cloud, the future is just pumping up all those flows together. Let's try out. Okay. Nice playground, right? So how does this look like in code? Let's scroll a bit down in this file. Again, you see the same structure as the previous demo. It's a sequence with three asynchronous steps. It's a bit elaborate, of course. Let's look into step one. Step one is kicking off a sub-orchestrator. Just for demo purposes, the sub-orchestrator does two activities. It performs the work and it communicates through a WebSocket towards the single-page application. And the nice puzzle here is the external event feature of the Durable Functions Framework. So you can set up a task. Please note there's no await keyword, so it's an asynchronous task. And you get a racing condition. So let's see, step one is an asynchronous task, and we have this cancellation task, that's an asynchronous task. And then the task framework, task parallel framework, will help us when any, which of the two will win. And the one that will win will define the logic that goes. In this case, you see that if the cancellation task wins, the cancellation message gets sent out towards the client. Okay, let's take a look at the sub-orchestrator. These are the trains or something? The sub-orchestrator example. A sub-orchestrator is just an orchestrator, but it makes you kicking off hierarchies of orchestrators. You see two activity functions being called synchronously after each other. The second one is kicking off a function that is communicating through WebSockets. Let's look at that a bit further. The signal R binding enables us to easily define a connection with Azure Signal R service. In this case, I introduced a hub on top of that with my name. Nice. And this is the API. It's using the iAsync collector interface to really queue up messages. And you can do a wait for that. Eventually, it gets flushed towards the client. At the site of Angular, we have nowadays the SignalR TypeScript library. It makes it very easy to integrate with TypeScript-based solutions. So let's see. It sets up a connection. It sets up the hub connection. Of course, this also needs to connect with the same hub name. And then it can start listening for events. So in this case, it's a durable event coming in, and we can do something in our single page application. All right. Then an intermezzo. There are a bit of constraints when you are writing your orchestrator code, because it has this replaying behavior every time the event source kicks in. So your orchestrator must be deterministic. You cannot have random behavior based on the generation of IDs or daytime now or doing I/O directly. It's not possible. And you cannot write infinite loops. Is this the end of our fantastic durable framework? Of course not. There are solutions. For daytime purposes, the context offers you a current daytime that is fixed for every replay, so you can leverage that. And the advice for I/O is please put it in activity functions and kick off activity functions. And for infinite loops, if you really want to have an orchestrator that never ends, you can use the continue as new. It just reschedules itself and kicks off again. Next demo, it's about flights. What would be nice to take a look at how to do looping and time management and how to monitor an external API. So let's kick off the demo. Even with my hotspot available, it looks like the map is rendered. Hopefully it will work. So this again kicks off an orchestrator. The orchestrator listens to a external flights API. The data comes in, and the airplanes gets plot on the map. It does this for 10 seconds, and every second new data is read from this external API. Oh yeah, and what I would like to show, hopefully I'm in time. There is Schiphol, and there's an airplane landing on Schiphol. So that's a fun fact. Let's look at the code. This is the orchestrator function for the monitoring. There is the end time gets calculated based on this context. This is the current daytime from the context. It adds 10 seconds. And here's your while loop. And there is a create timer. It schedules a task, and this timer is based on the current daytime plus 1 second. So the orchestrator really gets to sleep, and on the orchestrator queue there's a timer message to trigger the orchestrator function in the next second. So in this period of 1 second, you're not taking any consumption credits. Yes, and in this loop there you call an activity function to read out this external API and do something with the data. For example, everything within Utrecht signal a SMS or an email or red alert something. Let's see. So I've talked about looping, I've talked about time management, how to set up a long-running monitoring of an external API. Yet another intermezzo, big data, it's all about data-driven applications, right? So what was what was really fun to do for setting up this demo, we really needed to have some step data. So we looked into providers for flight data, and we found out this community, Open Sky Network, it's providing tons of data on flights. And one file for 1 hour is consists of 1 hour of data. 100 megabytes of data. So we really wanted to have a filtered experience because Future Tech is in Utrecht. We only were interested in the flights data in this neighborhood. So we learned about the Avro format. It's an Apache schema-rich data format specifically targeting data streaming purposes. I didn't know of any platform that was capable of reading Avro, but then I found out about Azure Databricks. It's the commercial offering of the Apache MapReduce platform for big data processing. So Avro format was, we were able to import it in Databricks and create an endpoint for Power BI, and eventually in Power BI we were able to query this clustered API and filter it for the data we were interested in. Then the story about how storage is organized within durable functions. So as said, there is a originally there was a service bus provider, and currently they offer the Azure storage provider as well. It's important to know that they defined the concept that is called Task Hub. What you may know is that the serverless function platform works with the concept of function apps. A function app is a logical group of functions, active functions, orchestrated functions. This task hub is really targeting on one particular function app. You cannot reuse a task hub across multiple function apps. Also, you might reckon now that your storage is filling up with all these event sources, historical data. So please plan your data lifecycle. For example, prune data after 6 months. The one thing maybe of interest, currently the durable framework is really taking a dependency on Azure storage, so it can only be run in the cloud, whereas Azure Functions, the Azure Functions host can run everywhere, so you can run it on an on-premise Kubernetes container, for example. So there are plans to introduce a new storage provider based on Redis Cache, and there's no plan available right now, but maybe we as a community can contribute and provide a Redis Cache implementation before Microsoft itself. It's a cool competition. Yes. Last but not least, our fan out demo. there is a man in the room who has helped me out with this, Frank Norlo. So at the coffee break, everyone can step to him. Let's see, 12:12. Let's take a look at the demo itself. Oh yeah, now I will take the cloud version. Hopefully it will run a bit. The orchestrator kicks in, tasks are scheduled in parallel for every frame it needs to render. There's a nice psychedelic experience. everyone is awake again, great. I must say that designing the front end was way more difficult than designing the durable function. So hopefully the parallel tasks will scale up towards 10 or something. Last time I currently it does not do that. But you can imagine that as soon as we kick off multiple of these, the consumption plan decides to scale up and do multiple frame renderings in parallel. Now we can set this will. Oh, nice. I need to quit this. Bye bye. Let's see. The code. So here you have the fan out orchestrator. It just does a for loop and schedules, in this case, 200 of these activity functions. And it does note again that the await keyword is not there, so it's an asynchronous task. And in this line, it will await all of these tasks. So you're really able to, after all those processing has taken place, you can create a video out of it. And I invite you all to write this code. Generate video awaiting your pull request. Greatly appreciated. What it essentially does is it writes the output towards blob storage. And through WebSockets, we communicate the frame that is ready towards the single page application, and the single page application reads from blob storage the frame and renders it on the screen. And then the last item for this talk, it's about hosting. So we're talking a lot about serverless compute and having zero consumption when there's no demand. That's on the left side, is the consumption plan. It enables you to rapidly scale out your components. It has unbounded scale out. Whereas the app service plan, the one caveat of the consumption plan is this cold start. So the first time from zero to one request, the platform needs to start up. So you have this bootstrap penalty. And the app service plan does not have that, it's always on. The limitation is there, you have this 5-minute delay in auto-scaling, and even there's no unbounded scale, you have a fixed scale out on that side. Good news is that Microsoft has a private preview with regards to a new improved app service plan. It provides best of both worlds, rapid scale out always on in combination with unbounded scale out. I believe I've told you everything. Frank Norlois, I already thanked him. Lucas Scalier is one of my front-end acquaintance. Thanks for your attention.